Hi, my name is Alicia Wilson. I'm the director of kids at Lifepoint Church. And one way we wanted to spread positivity to you this week is to introduce you to our newest Lifepoint family member, Micah George Phillip.
Good morning. We're glad you're here. Welcome to Lifepoint Church. Remember to
stay positive.
Louder than Well, good morning, everybody, and welcome to Lifepoint Church. It's such a privilege to have you with us this morning. My name is Andy, and I'm the pastor here at Lifepoint Church. Is anybody ready to meet back together again? Well, on September the 6th, we are officially going to be regathering in person at Lifepoint Church. And in order to make that happen, we wanted to let you know that we still need some volunteers. And I want to make it very clear that if you sign up to volunteer, you're not signing up to volunteer every week. Even if you can only volunteer once a month, that's great. We're just looking for some more volunteers. Volunteers in the kids area, volunteers to help pull off all of the tech, volunteers to help with our cafe. So if you feel like you might be able to give us one Sunday a month and just volunteer, you'll be getting an email, and in that email you'll have the opportunities to sign up through that. You can also email us at info@azlifepoint.com and let us know that you would like to volunteer. Now, we are getting ready to regather. We're just a couple of weeks away. So on September 6th, a Sunday, the first Sunday in September, we're going to be regathering. And I want to let you know that we're taking a lot of precautions, and we're actually really excited about all that's going to be happening on that first Sunday. So be on the lookout. We're going to be making a little video of a tour of the facility and all the precautions that we're taking so that we can make sure that when we gather together, we're doing so in a way that's both safe but also really exciting. Today, we have the opportunity of praying for a church here in town that has one of my favorite names. Their name is the Rincon Valley Cowboy Church. So they're excited. They just purchased 9 acres and they're getting ready to build. So Pastor Joe Grizzle has asked us to pray for that property. So if you would join me this morning as we pray for our service. Heavenly Father, we come before you. We thank you for the opportunity that we have each and every Sunday to worship you. We thank you that we have the opportunity to come and worship you through music, through the hearing of your word, and soon, very soon, through the fellowship of believers. And Lord, we just pray that you would continue to move this COVID season in the right direction, that the cases would continue to dwindle so that we can not only meet together again, but we can do so in a way that is safe. Lord, we just pray for all that's going on in the life of our church. We pray for all the ministries, the volunteers that are needed. We pray for the future of our church. We're excited to be in contract with our very own land, and we pray that you would give us wisdom and discernment as we move forward of what that looks like. Lord, we pray that you would provide for us the resources, the people, all that we need to build ourselves a home. Heavenly Father, we also pray for Pastor Joe Grizzle and the Cowboy Church, and excited that they are in a similar situation, that they too have their own land and they're looking to set up a home. And Lord, we pray that you would bless them, that you would provide them all that they need, and that that home would be a place to reach many people for you. Lord, we also just come before you. We are in an interesting season of life. Lord, there's so much going on in our world. Everything from the issues revolving around race, the issues evolving around COVID, the issues revolving around the upcoming election. Lord, we just pray that you would give us unbelievable discernment, that you would help us to really recognize what it is that's happening in our world, in our culture, and Lord, how we can look to you for guidance and strength, knowing that when we do so, that you will speak. And Lord, we just pray that you would give us that wisdom, and we pray that you would give our leaders that wisdom, leaders of other churches, pastors of other churches, both here in Tucson and around the world. We also pray for our doctors who are trying to come up with solutions, vaccines, whatever it may be, to fight off COVID. Lord, we also pray for all of our medical workers who are tirelessly working and caring for loved ones in a situation that puts themselves in harm's way. We also, Lord, pray for our teachers. Lord, with school starting back up and just knowing that there has to be a fear in their lives, stepping into a situation which is just full of uncertainty, we pray your protection over them. We pray for protection over the students who are attending again in person. We pray for moms and dads who are staying home and homeschooling, for students who are joining in online. Lord, we just pray that you would provide for them, that you would help them to have all that they need to not only thrive, but to find joy, peace, hope, and joy. And Lord, we do pray for all of our governing officials as well. Lord, for our President Donald Trump. We even pray for all the candidates who are coming forward and applying for different roles here in the U.S. We pray, God, that you would raise up leaders who love you, raise up leaders who would support laws that would honor you. Lord, we pray that you would help us as Christians to know how we should vote. Lord, that we would be ones who do our research. And Lord, we also just pray for unity amongst our country. Lord, that as the election nears, God, and whatever the results, God, that we would not move into a time of anarchy, but Lord, we would just move into a season of unity, and that we would do all that we can to have peace, but ultimately point people to you, which is where peace comes from. Lord, we just lift up this morning to you. We lift up Preston to you and his message that he has for us. Lord, may it speak to our hearts, that it would challenge us, that we would leave different. And we pray all this in your son's name. Amen. Well, here we have this morning's message by our student ministry director, Preston Wilson.
When your car is broken too, there's only one thing you wanna do. Open your mouth and let it spew. But I am telling you, stay positive. When you're baking a cake for your family, your kids are hopped up on caffeine, your fluffy cake is now kinda lean. Remember, don't be mean, stay positive.
Hi everyone, my name is Preston Wilson, the director of students here at LifePoint. I know you heard it in the announcements already, but can you guess what's happening September 6th? That's right, in-person church again. There's been a lot of thought, a lot of actions, a lot of prayer that have gone into this, so we're all very, very excited to be together again. What this means for you is that you're gonna have to take regular showers again, and maybe even put pants on. You know, 6 months ago, toilet paper was flying off the shelf, but I have a feeling there's actually gonna be a new product flying off the shelf. Razors. People gonna have to shave again. Dan's gonna have to shave that awful beard again. All these new things. Well, thank you for joining us this morning. We're truly glad that you're here. I personally believe that it's for a reason and for a purpose that you're watching this morning, wherever you're at. So thank you. We're in our third week of our series, Stay Positive. And I hope that you've been encouraged throughout this series. I hope that you've gone away just more encouraged. And today as well. I hope that for today as well. Encouragement comes in many different ways, verbally, nonverbal, emotionally, even in our own minds. And as we all know, it can be really, really difficult to get into the encouragement in our lives when we have to go through so much negativity first. But does it have to be in that order? Do we have to go through the negative in order to get to the good? When I was a kid, we didn't get to eat out hardly at all, which really is a testament to how hard my mom worked, providing for a family. Shout out to my mom. Love you, Mom. Joanne Wilson, love you. But every now and then, when we would get to go out to a meal, one of the most exciting meals for me to eat was pizza. Pizza, right? I mean, if you're with me, if pizza's it, type preach it in the side chat right now. But they came out with this new pizza. Never had done it before. It was called stuffed crust. What? It's because of this pizza that I am the man before you today. So I would be eating this pizza with the way that most people would consider the correct way, you know, at the point, and you eat it normally. And really, I'm just eating this pizza so that I could get to the end of the cheesy stuffed crust. But finally, one day, I realized something profound. Are you ready? I realized that if you turn the pizza slice around, you can actually start with the good stuff. See, we sometimes think that we need to involve the negative into our lives in order to get the good stuff. And not realizing that if we just turn that around, We don't have to go through the negative things of this life before we can get to the good stuff. And please know what I'm saying when I say the good stuff here is when we surrender to God's authority, that He'll be with us through this life and He works things for the good for us. So how do we do this? This is the good stuff. How do we do this? How do we get to the good? We must have a change in our thinking, a mind change. And this is done through faith in Jesus Christ. It's a new way of thinking about life because we take on the mind of Christ. This becomes the way a Christian should think, because if we think like a Christian should, then we will act like a Christian should act. Did you know that God's peace will guard your mind as you live in Christ? It's in Philippians 4, verses 6 through 7. It says, "Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank Him for all that He has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Jesus Christ." Your mind is guarded from the negative and sinfulness of this world as you live in Christ Jesus. This means that there's no separation between you and Jesus in your relationship. We need this life in Jesus Christ now in our lives as we're in the thick of this bad news going on. The title of today's message is Enough of the Bad News. With so much that is negative that surrounds our lives, and you'll encounter these negative stories no matter what you do. It's all over the media, it's all over the news, it's all over social media, which has become what I call it, the great divide. And these divisions are over people's opinions, both informed and uninformed. Anybody else experiencing the great divide on social media? Yeah, remember when social media used to just be like, let's go see what old Martha and Pete were eating for dinner and how their food was cooked on a grill that Pete got for his birthday. And he got it on their birthday in Montana, where all the grandkids are living right now. I never thought that I would actually say this. But I miss those days. I miss those simple social media days. Now, Pete and Martha are on social media and they've solved the economic crisis in our country and they figured out how to solve world hunger overnight. I mean, seriously, what's happened to us? Does anybody else watching this feel that way? It can become so easy to get sucked into all the negativity and the fear and the anxiety that seems to overwhelm so many people. And if I could just be transparent with you for just a moment, there are many different times when I find myself more emotionally on edge, or I find myself getting easily angered. It's almost a good thing that there's social distancing, because it doesn't take much sometimes to get me upset right now, and probably you. Maybe you find yourself more easily discouraged and often just kind of wake up feeling like, can we ever rebuild this? Can we ever go back to something that's meaningful? I've often felt these things myself, so what I'm doing right now, personally, I'm really, really asking God to help me see the good in the middle of all the bad. I'm fighting to keep a perspective of faith and a very positive attitude, and to have an attitude of faith, to look for the good in the middle of the bad, and to believe that God is still on His throne, that He's still working, and that He can be in this, and He can be with us, and that He's still for us. Stay positive, fight for faith, because a negative outlook never ever leads to a positive life. What I wanna do today is I wanna show you why I'm unshakably optimistic about the future. So enough of the bad news, let's talk about optimism. And what I wanna do is I wanna first tell you what optimism is not, so we can be very, very clear, and then I wanna help try to define what optimism is. So let's start with what optimism is not. What optimism is not. We're going to start there. First of all, optimism is not the denial of reality. It's not putting our heads in the sand and acting like everything's just okay and nothing's going wrong in the world. Just have a positive attitude no matter what, or deny reality. The reality is that we have very significant challenges all over the world. Optimism is not a denial of reality. It's also not blind faith. It's not just naive, wishful thinking that everything's going to work out. If we don't even do anything about it, it's just going to work out. It's not denial of reality, and it's not blind faith. A definition online that I read, a very clear definition, is optimism is simply confidence about the future or a successful outcome. It's a confidence believing that something good is coming, or an assurance, a belief that there's going to be a positive or successful outcome. What I want to do is I want to add some spiritual weight to that definition of optimism. So this would be my definition with some faith added. So this is how you as a faith-filled Christian can be optimistic. Here's how. What is optimism? Optimism is the unwavering expectation that our loving God is working every situation for our future good. It's the unwavering expectation. It's an assurance deep within our souls that our loving God, He's involved. He's working in every situation for our future good. In fact, it was Paul who said this very thing in Romans. It was Romans 8:28. He said, "And we know that in all things our God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose." It might be your impossible boss. It might be your financial setback. Or it could be the challenges of home educating your kids. You might want to pause on that one for a second. In other words, even in a negative situation, it still holds the potential to produce a positive purpose. Because we as faith-filled believers can live with the unwavering expectation that our loving God is working in every situation for our future good. I'm incredibly optimistic. So what I want to do for you for a moment is I want you to just kind of pause. I want you to think for just a moment. I want you to think about what you think about. I want you to think about how you process your thoughts about the future. Okay, so just take a moment and think about how you process your thoughts for the future. How do you see the future in your thought life? Because the reality is, if our thoughts are consumed with negativity and fear and worry and anxiety, that's really, really bad news. Because what consumes your mind tends to control your life. Let me say that again. What consumes your mind tends to control your life. Whatever you think about tends to direct your life. In other words, the life that you have is generally a reflection of the thoughts that you think. Proverbs tells us that whatever a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Your life is generally moving in the direction of your strongest thoughts. So if you tend to think the world is always in trouble and you can't trust anyone and I hate my circumstances, you're probably not going to get to the end of that day and think, wow, this has been the best day ever. If you wake up with a bad attitude and a bad perspective and a bad filter and you see everything through a pessimistic lens, what you think about tends to direct your life. What consumes your thoughts controls your life. And that's why the quality of your life will exceed the quality of your thoughts. What do you think about? What do you think about? This is one of the big problems with pessimism. Those who have consistently chronically negative attitude, experts will tell us about pessimists. Pessimists tend to view negative events both as personal and permanent. They're personal. That means that it's not my fault. This is happening to me because I'm bad. I'm no good. Nothing ever goes my way. I'm incapable. I'm unworthy of anything good. And then they tend to think that it's permanent. This is always going to be this way. I'm never going to have a good life. We're always going to struggle. Anybody felt that way? Things are bad and they're just going to get worse. And before long, we start to live with a very real victim mentality. Here's what we have to recognize, that being content and being satisfied, being blessed, being optimistic, it isn't a state of affairs. It's a state of mind. What controls your mind controls your life. So what consumes your thoughts controls your life. So what consumes your thoughts? I want you to think about what you think about. What consumes your thoughts? Are your thoughts typically drifting towards faith and God and optimism and belief about His power and His goodness in your life? Or do they tend to drift towards the negative? I'm just concerned. I'm worried all the time. The world's literally falling apart before my eyes. If you move towards the negative, and if I can be kind of honest with you this morning, I have to fight for an attitude of faith because my nature, I tend to be a realist. I tend to be concerned and I tend to drift towards negative things. And if you find yourself there, what I want you to do is I want you to feed your faith. I want you to starve the negativity. Feed your faith and starve your fears. Why? Because whatever you feed tends to grow, and whatever you starve tends to die. What I want to do is I want to starve the wrong voices that rob me of any potential joy in my life, and I want to feed the things that help me grow in my faith. That doesn't mean I put my head in the sand or that you should put your head in the sand. It means refocus your mind on things that will feed your spirit. One of the most valuable things that I do is I take a rich portion of Scripture and I try to get into that Scripture so that that Scripture gets into me. I don't just read through the Scripture, but I'm trying to live it. I'm going to live in it. I'm going to focus on it. I'm going to meditate on that Scripture. I'm going to think about it. I'm going to let it work and start to renew my mind. I'm going to give you an example of this. And since we're talking about Romans 8:28, the power of God that works things for the good, so I want to show you how I would go through Romans 8 here in order for me to feed my faith. And you can practice this yourself. This is a great tool to do. So I'll take the rich portion of Scripture like this, like Romans 8. And first, all I want to understand the context of the passage, not just reading it, but I want to know who wrote it. To whom was it written? Why was it written? And what's going on the verses before that, what I'm reading. And so I know that the Apostle Paul was writing a very rich, meaty, weighty letter to the Romans. And I know that Romans 8 comes after Romans 7. So I think about Romans 7. And in Romans 7, I love Romans 7 because Paul was just kind of a mess. He's going on this rant like, I don't understand myself. And to just put it kind of in modern day language, he's kind of saying, I'm just a mess up. The things that I want to do, I don't do them. And the things I know I don't want to do, I end up doing. I'm such a mess. He's just a mess in these things. But then he shifts in Romans 8, and it's almost like he's talking himself out of his negativity and his dysfunction and his sinfulness. In the very beginning, he says this of chapter 8, therefore now there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. If you're in Christ Jesus, there's no judgment for your sins. Your sins have been forgiven. Paul makes this really hard turn as he starts to renew his mind. He talks about the mind that's on the flesh or on the things of the flesh, but the mind that's on the Spirit lives for the things of the Spirit. He says, if you're led by the Spirit, you're children of God. If you're focusing on the Spirit, your mind will be at peace. And then it might just land in a portion of text like Romans 8:18. Where this is what Paul says. He says that I consider our present sufferings are not worth comparing to the glory that will be revealed in us. I'm going to read that. I'm going to let that read me to feel it. When he says, I consider that our present suffering, all these things that we hate, that we're enduring, that are so incredibly painful, our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. So I remind myself, okay, the Apostle Paul wrote this. How did he suffer? Well, he was imprisoned multiple times. That's kind of worse than what I'm going through right now. He was beaten. 5 times he was beaten with 40 lashes. That's pretty bad. 3 times he was beaten with rods. Rocks were thrown at him. He was stoned. He was shipwrecked. He spent the night out at sea. He was bitten by a snake. Remember, he shook it off in the fire. He was betrayed. He was beaten. The guy was left for dead on the side of the road. He didn't even look like he was alive anymore. And this is the guy who said, our present sufferings are not worth comparing to the glory that is to come. I let that feed my faith. Our present sufferings aren't worth comparing to the glory that is to come. This is feeding your faith and starving your fear. So I'd ask you, where are you hurting right now? What have you lost? Where are you experiencing hardship that deeply grieves your soul? I know that there's some of you that are facing a job loss right now, and that's real suffering. Some of you might be sick or have relatives that are. Some are battling diseases like cancer. I know most of all of us have been affected by that. Some of you have relational challenges right now in your marriage and with your kids. Whatever it is, it is a hardship. What we can do is we can tell ourselves what the scripture teaches us, essentially, that the struggle I'm in today is producing the strength I need for tomorrow. It's not even worth comparing. This momentary trial, this momentary struggle is not even worth comparing to the glory that will be revealed in us. What a hope. What a hope that is. I've got an unwavering expectation that our loving God is working in every situation for our future good. So I starve my fears. I feed my faith. We let God's word start to renew our mind, because your life is always moving in the directions of your strongest thoughts. So if you're hurting right now, who is God? He's your comfort. If you're feeling confused, He's your guide. If you find yourself discouraged, He's your hope. He's your hope. Feed your faith and starve your fears. If you're anxious, He's your peace. And if you're weak, God is your strength. So I feed my faith and I starve my fears. And as followers of Christ, don't ever lower your expectations. Raise your expectations in the goodness and the faithfulness and in the power of our God. So many people I've heard say this, I just want life to get back to normal. I just want to get back to normal. I've got more faith in that. I know there's a lot of you who want to go back to normal, and I'm remembering that a lot of you were actually complaining about your life 5 or 6 months ago. I did it. We were all whiny about how we had so much to do, and now you actually want to go back to that? I've got faith in God that we can go back to something better than normal. Amen? That He can do something in us. I may not like what I'm going through, but I appreciate what God will produce out of this present pain. God is working in all things to bring about the good. Remember that. I believe by faith that God can do exceedingly, abundantly, more than we could ask or imagine, according to His power. I'm believing that going through this, there are some of you, you're going to come out on the other side and your marriages are going to be stronger. I'm optimistic that some of you, your families will be closer, that your love is going to be deeper for one another, and that your generosity is going to become greater, that there are Christians who are going to become even more bold in their faith, that the light of the church will shine brighter, and that the harvest is going to be bigger because we lift up the name of Jesus, the name above every name. I'm optimistic in the goodness and the faithfulness of God. There's nothing that's going to stop the love of God through His church, for His church. His church always prevails. His word is always true. His presence never leaves us. He never, ever forsakes us. And so I feed my faith and I starve my fears. Romans 8:38-39. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. I tell myself, no matter where I go, my God is there. No matter what happens to me, my God is for me. And that's why I have an unwavering expectation that our loving God is working in every situation for our future good. So enough of the bad news. Let's acknowledge it. We've got some problems, but we have a bigger God. So rather than be consumed by fear and anxiety, I'm going to believe that our present struggles aren't even worth comparing to the future glory of what God is going to do in us and through us. Whenever I'm discouraged and weak, I remind myself His spirit is perfect. In my weakness, His strength is perfect. I may not see Him, but He's still present and He's still good. And even when our enemy means something for evil, our God can turn it into good because there's nothing, not a disease, not a sickness, not any fear that can separate us from the love of God that's in Christ Jesus our Lord. And so I know that what consumes my mind controls my life. My life is always moving in the direction of my strongest thoughts. That the life I have is a reflection of the thoughts that I think. So think this way. My God has not given me a spirit of fear, but of power and love and of a sound mind. So I starve my fears and I feed my faith. Enough of the bad news. Let me tell you some really good news. We call this the good news of the gospel. And the gospel is the best news ever. The gospel is this. It is the message of hope that we have all sinned. We have all fallen short of the glory of God. None of us deserve God's forgiveness, but He's allowed us through faith in Jesus Christ to be forgiven of our sin. Some good news. And we need to know that we need Jesus as our Savior. Our goodness doesn't get us into heaven. Our good deeds, it doesn't help us achieve salvation. It is through faith in Jesus Christ alone and confessing that He is Lord. The good news is that our God loves us even though we have sinned. And while we were still sinning, Scripture says, Jesus, the sinless Son of God, died on a cross and God raised Him from the dead so that we could be forgiven. In other words, the way that you're made right with God is not based on your religious efforts and that you stopped doing bad and you just started doing good. The way that you're made right with God is by placing your faith in the perfect work of Jesus, the risen Son of God. And when you call on Jesus, God hears your prayer. He forgives your sin. And you're not just saved from eternal death, but you're saved for a life of joy and victory, reflecting His love on this earth. Those of you who recognize you feel guilt, you feel the weight of your sin, and you don't know where you stand with God, if you call on the name that is above every name, the name of Jesus, God hears your prayers. He forgives your sins. You become a brand new creation. And you're made right with God because of the perfect work of Jesus. Those who say, I need His grace. I want His forgiveness. I want to put my trust in Him. Those who say, yes, I need His forgiveness today, right now. I call on His name. I want this forgiveness. I surrender my life. Jesus, I give my life to You. If that's you today, pray this prayer with me. Right where you are, let's pray. God, I recognize the sin in my life, and I see the separation that it causes between You and me. And God, I ask You to remove this sin from my life. I trust You, God. I give You my life. I believe in Jesus Christ living a perfect, sinless life, dying on the cross in my place from the sins that I have, the punishment that I deserve, and raising again from the dead to offer me new life, to become a new creation. God, forgive me of my sins through the blood of Jesus Christ shed for me. Jesus, I ask You to be my Savior, to rule in my life, to be Lord over my life. I surrender all authority, everything I think that I can control, I give to You. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. If you prayed that prayer this morning, would you go to info@azlifepoint.com and just let us know that you prayed that prayer, that you received Jesus as your Lord and Savior. We not only want to celebrate with you, but we would love to give you some direction on where to go next and how to build your faith. So let us partner with you. Remember to stay positive and enough with the bad news. Feed your faith and see it grow through the Word of God. Have a great week.
Much deeper.